Welcome, everybody. My name is Jonathan Brown. I'm the director of the Center for Muslim Christian Understanding. And we welcome you and our guest, Faris Kaya, to be presenting today about one of the most important figures in Islam in Turkey, namely Bediuzzaman Said Nursi. Mr. Kaya is the director of the Istanbul Foundation for Science and Culture in Turkey, IIKV. If any of you know anything about Turkey, you know it's absolutely full of these wonderful vakf foundations, kind of think tanks, libraries, cultural associations that provide a really robust life of the mind in society. The foundation is dedicated to the dissemination of the late Muslim scholar Bediuzzaman Said Nursi. He died in the 1960s, of his ideas and works. It's organized conferences, seminars, and symposia in many countries around the world, including Indonesia, Algeria, Yemen, and Chad. So we welcome Mr. Kaya, and I have to say this food is really good. So we're going to have to be nourished bodily and soul by our speaker and the food. So please,
hopefully,
commence.
Yeah, you are fed with food, but I am not sure about intellectually. Good afternoon. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Thank you very much, Dr. Brown, head of the Center of Walid. Huh? Now, I'm sure you know a bit of Bediuzzaman Said Nursi, but I would like to give a very brief introduction. Who is Said Nursi and about his, you know, period of time and what he did, and then later on about his books and writings, a bit introduction. Then we will be going, you know, let me, you know, brief his thought and his perspective living in a secular environment, his understanding of today's hot topic, jihad, in the world, and Nursi and politics, Muslim-Christian relations, and his legacy, a bit, you know. And I hope that I can, you know, brief in half an hour time. Then perhaps we can, you know, expand it, open it with your questions and, of course, contributions. There, Professor Haddad. Now, Said Nursi was born, Said Nursi was born in 1876 in Eastern Anatolia, in remote, you know, Kurdish area. Today is called Bitlis. So the village that he was born called Nurs, so that's why he's called Nursi. And the name of Bediüzzaman was given to him because he had given an extraordinary capability of learning and memorizing. He used to memorize about 90 basic books. Today, you know, we have that sort of people that having what they call it photographic memory. Nursi also had that type of memory, but usually those people who have, you know, memorizing capacity, they have, you know, they lack learning capability. So Nursi had both of them. Then one of his teachers called him Bediüzzaman, gave the name Bediüzzaman. Bediüzzaman is wonder of the age. So he was born in Bitlis, and he got his basic education around, you know, his village. When we are talking 1870s, we don't have, you know, aircraft, we don't have, you know, motor vehicles, we don't have, you know, that sort of things. And he was, you know, just going around. And during the, I'm going to be very brief, during the First World War, he was, you know, captured as capture of war by Russians with a broken leg, and he was exiled to Central Siberia, a place called Kostroma. I have visited Kostroma, 500 kilometers north of Moscow. And he returned back from Russian exile in 1918 in Istanbul. And that time, Istanbul was under the occupation of Western forces. He struggled, you know, literally. And then later on he was invited by Mustafa Kemal to join the National Front in Ankara. He went there, but he found that Mustafa Kemal was difficult to work with Mustafa Kemal, and he had in the mind, you know, this changing all, you know, religious, feelings and things and rules and regulations and laws, etc. And he left Ankara for his homeland town, Van, in 1923. And he was then again exiled in 1925 to western remote village called Barla in Sparta, in western part of Turkey. And that was Nursi's, you know, first place to start to begin writing his faith-based Quranic commentary called Risale-i Nur, the Epistles of Light. And Risale-i Nur comprised about 6,000 pages of Quranic commentary, mostly dedicated to faith matters, proving the existence of God, proving the hereafter, resurrection, angels, and the prophethood, the truth of prophethood in general. And he ran into difficulties with, you know, the court cases again, you know, and he was taken three times mainly to court. And all his lifelong, you know, time from 1925 till he died 1960, either he was in prison or on exile. And we will later on come to that point that when he was, you know, very harshly treated by secularist Kemalist government, he never attempted to physical confrontation. He always took, you know, the peaceful, but peaceful resistance against aggressive secularism of Turkey. Yeah, coming back to, you know, about his views and ideas, as I said, he wrote Risale-i Nur. The Risale-i Nur, you know, talks about the basic concepts of Quran, like divine unity, the resurrection, justice, and, you know, religious, you know, duties and obligations, and also about angels, women, elderly, youth, sick, calamities, prophetic traditions, prophetic stories in Quran, the miracles of Quran, etc. It is, you know, quite a big and volume work, and it is available in English and in Arabic as whole, you know, copies, a set, and also it is available now, most of it is available more than 60 different languages worldwide. His perspective, living in an, as I said, secular environment, was, you know, one of the significant, actually, characteristics of Said Nursi, his Risale-i collection, and his community. And one thing that I would like to express here, to your kind attention, that Nursi's community does not dependent on people and persons. He said that, "I am a transient person, fani." What is fani in English?
Transient, transitory.
Yeah, transitory, fani.
Mortal.
Well, is mortal usually, mortal doesn't have negative effect, but fani means I will die away.
Yeah.
And he said that my books are the things that to be followed, not me. And from that point, his students never become his khalifa. Okay, so in our tradition, Nursi's community, we don't say my sheikh, my, you know, we say abi. Abi in Turkish means elder brother. Yeah, So just, you know, a bit of respect, that's all. But we usually refer to Risale-i Nur, not persons. Not Said Nursi's life, but his thought, his writings. His writings can be categorized in three, you know, parts. One is about faith matters. Second part is about his defenses in court cases, because it is very important to study and see how he defended himself when he was questioned in the court. He was usually three times, I think, he was asked by the prosecutor death sentence, but he never mentioned that I am not guilty, I didn't do that, etc. Whenever he was questioned, he expressed what he actually wanted to do, and about the contents of his writings, his belief that this world is a guest house and we'll be going to an eternal world, etc. And he, during his time, in 1923-1960, there were, you know, very strict, aggressive de-Islamization practice took place. Actually, it's not only de-Islamization, I can say de-religization. Is it possible to say that? You can help me. You know, I mean, because not only Islams, Christians, and Jewish also, they have been, you know, pushed back. During the Ottoman time, all religions were respected. Although the religion of the state was Islam, but they respected Christianity and Judaism. And you may know that from Spain about 500 years ago, when Jewish was forced, they moved to Ottoman land. So three, you know, heavenly religions and, you know, other type of believers also were respected, received respect from the state and from other people. But during the Republican time, unfortunately, this was not the case. But Said Nursi never abandoned what he wanted to do, but he never also abandoned peaceful resistance and coexistence within aggressive secularist regime. And he asked his students, never do physical uprise, okay, do physical resistance. Because he said that, I think, I care, my basic concerns are about innocence. Because during the physical, you know, resistance, I will explain maybe in detail in the section of jihad, mostly innocent peoples are harmed. As we can see today in Syria, in Iraq, in many other, you know, in Palestine, in many other, you know, violence area. And Nursi's basic mission was to do a sort of spiritual resistance, fighting, struggle against challenges of modernity and misconcept of civilization. Now I'm just, you know, giving a very short introduction about what Nursi thinks of civilization. He divides civilization into two. One, worldly, materialism-based civilization, and the other one is heavenly, revelation-based civilization. Even he categorizes European civilization also like this into two. He says, oh, first Europe, and then second Europe. The one Europe which is which left, you know, heavenly instructions of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, and the other Europe which produced, you know, good things for the betterment and life of humanity, getting, you know, sort of, you know, revelation-driven you know, aspect from the these three heavenly religions. Now, Nursi, let me just, you know, very briefly touch here. He says that materialist philosophy accepts force as its point of support in the life of society. So they want to have force. If you have force, it's okay. If you don't have force, then you are lost. This is the one of the important standpoint of materialist philosophy. The second one, it considers the aims to be benefits. The aim of materialist philosophy is benefit only, to get, you know, benefit. Selfishness. And the third one, the principle of his life is recognizes to be conflict. Always, you know, they want to create conflicts. And the fourth one, the bond between communities to be nationalism, racism. And the fifth, its fruits are gratifying the appetites of soul and increasing human needs. You see, if the needs are more, then everybody, you know, works to get in order to satisfy their benefits, etc. Now, about revelation based, now let me just continue. He says that, however, the mark of force is aggression. The mark of benefit, since they are insufficient for every desire, is jostling and tussling, while the mark of conflict is strife, and the mark of nationalism, racism, since it is nourished by endowing others, is aggression. It is for this reason that it has negated the happiness of humanity in total. Muslim, non-Muslim, believer, non-believer, whatever, you know, nationality they belong to. And for the Quranic or revelation-based civilization, he says that the point of support is truth instead of force. Somewhere, Nursi says that force is created in order to support truth. Force, when it is alone, it is dangerous, he says. And the second, it takes virtue and God's pleasure as its aims in place of benefits. So, the pleasure of God. So what we do, Muslims, Christians, Jewish, whatever religion we are belong to, the driving force should be the pleasure of the happiness of God. And third, it takes the principle of mutual assistance as the principle of life in place of principle of conflict. And the fourth one, and it takes the ties of religion, class, and country to be the ties bounding communities, not nationalism. Okay. And the fifth, its aim to form a barrier against the lust of soul, urge the spirit to sublime matters, satisfy the high emotions, and urging man to the human perfections, make him a true human being, a true servant of God. Now, this is the, you know, his concept of, his very short introduction about his concept of civilization. Coming back to, you know, the mainstream that I was, you know, giving to you. The fourth principle point is that I want to touch here about jihad. Jihad perhaps needs, you know, a very special attention to be paid nowadays, and in the past also was so. In Islam, it is true that there is jihad, physical jihad today. As we go to the writings of Ibn Qayyum al-Jawzi, he is the student of Ibn Taymiyyah. He categorizes jihad into 13, you know, category, and only one of them is physical jihad. The other 12 are different kind of jihad. Jihad with words, jihad with, you know, sympathy, jihad with, you know, helping others, you know, jihad with education, jihad with spiritual jihad, you know, improving people's, you know, moral values, etc., etc. And Nursi takes this and says that, just let me, you know, go back. You know who is Ibn Taymiyyah? I'm sure you know him. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi is his student, and today's, you know, these wrong jihadist movements like, you know, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and all those people, they base their ideas on Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi's, you know, views and ideas. Why? They take it extremely. They go extremes. And Nursi says that, yes, there is a need for physical jihad. When your country is under attack. And for Nursi, physical jihad is allowed only as defense. You cannot attack others. Clearly mentioned in his writings. And he took part of, and he practiced this jihad in his life against Russian invasion. And he was taken with broken leg. During that time, when there were war, you know, fighting between Ottoman, you know, and Russian and Armenian armies. And it is documented well by French journalists of that time that Nursi always saved Armenian children and women from the massacre by, you know, Ottoman army. I mean, physical jihad also has a rule to be obeyed in Islam. You cannot simply, you know, say Allahu Akbar and kill others. This is unacceptable, you know, what they are doing today, you know. And Nursi says that since today destruction is spiritual, jihad also should be spiritual. Spiritual jihad. Jihad manevi equals. Jihad with words instead of jihad with swords. He emphasizes and he practiced in his life. As I said, that there are, you know, three categories of Risale-i Nur, one on faith matters, other one for court defense, and the third one about his letters to his students. And in those letters, he always advises spiritual jihad. He says, because if there is a physical jihad within a country, it is inevitable that innocent people will be harmed. And he mentions about 60, 70 times this verse, clear cut in Quran, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. And its meaning is that no one can be punished because of the, you know, guilt of his relatives, father, mother, brother, sister, countrymen, etc. And Nursi says, if physical jihad takes place within a country, then this basic Quranic law will be violated and will lead, you know, violation and terror. It becomes a terror. And Nursi puts in a very clear-cut, you know, description. In a boat, if there is one innocent person, 90 guilty person, and that boat cannot be sunk, he says. Why? Because of that innocent person. So preserving life of an innocent comes before punishing 99 guilty person. Actually, 99 is just figure, maybe 99,000, 1 million. Because preserving life of innocent person comes first for Nursi. And Nursi and politics, I have just, you know, because I have only 5 minutes, he says in short, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان والسياسة. Yeah. Why did you laugh? He says, I run away from politics as I run away from Satan. He said that because politics of this time makes people double faced. Maybe it was the case before he died, but today maybe multiple faced. Yeah. And he says that politics, a poison, kills sincerity. And politics kills spirituality. Politics, you know, kills the spiritual or religious sensitivity. Okay, you know, in politics you say okay, like this, you know, because you always become pragmatist, and with pragmatism you lose, you know, religious sensitivity. So that's why he said, "A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani wa siyasi." And he says his students, there will be a need always for you to be an advisor, a warner to the politicians that don't do wrong, don't do wrong. And his students say, if we are an advisor and warner to the politicians, if they continue doing harm, let them do. It's not your responsibility. Your responsibility is only with tongue to warn them. And he says that from now onward, always there will be a need for a community staying away from politics and advising whatever government is there. Being advisor, sincere warners. And about his ideas regarding Muslim-Christian relations, I think I don't want, you know, to talk much about this. You know, Tom Mitchell, Father Tom Mitchell, this book by him. Yeah. Can we present these books to this center?
Sure.
Because from his library.
Oh, no, yes. No. It's from your library.
No, he may have extra copies. Oh,
Tom Mitchell is often on our board, so we probably already have.
Yeah. Books. Yeah, this book from A to Z and talks about Nursi's, you know, views and ideas concerning other religions, Christianity and Judaism. And Tom Mitchell, in this book, in short, he says that first I began to study Nursi as academical interest, but later on I started reading him for my own benefit, to improve my faith, to expand and widen my knowledge regarding God and faith matters. And another book by president of Virginia Theological Seminary. You may know him, Professor Ian Markham. He is an Anglican priest and professor of theology, engaging with Bediuzzaman Said Nursi, a model of interfaith dialogue. Actually, in this book, Ian Markham says that Nursi's dialogue, interfaith dialogue, is different than what we have today, you know. And today's dialogue, he says, looks like industrialized, you know, of dialogue, making money, you know, coming together, having, you know, this sort of double face and saying that, okay, I love you, you love me, you know, I respect you, you respect me, like that. But in Nursi's case, no. Nursi actually inviting in his writings all my students of Risale-i Nur and Christian missionaries, come together, put aside whatever differences you have temporarily, unite your forces against aggressive secularism and atheistic materialism in order to save future of, you know, new generations, he says. We have differences. It is for sure that, you know, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, you know. But we have common things that we are sailing on the same boat in this universe, you see. We have to gain, you know, save our hereafter life. And this book is also by, again, Ian Markham. He wrote three books. An Introduction to Said Nursi, The Life and Thought, and his writings. Ian Markham, he says that in this book, all religions need Said Nursi. But unfortunately, in Christianity, we don't have Said Nursi. That's why I'm reading Said Nursi, he says. Yeah. To widen my faith, my belief, and my spirituality, he says. And one, interesting anecdote I would like to explain here. Before Turkey became republic during the Sultan Abdulhamid time, Nursi asked people not to call Christians and Jewish as kafir. You know, kafir, meaning of kafir, means disbeliever, unbeliever. And this is why. He said that they are not kafir. They believe in God. We may differ on the attributes and names of God, but we believe in the same God that created all of us. But so he was very sensitive using, you know, terms and terminologies. Yet he was very deep and very stick to Islamic values and Islamic teaching. About his legacy, I would like to say a few words. More than 100 international conferences, symposiums, seminars were held all over the world, from Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, India, Iran, most of Middle Eastern countries, in United States, in Canada, in Europe, you know, in United Kingdom, in Germany, Italy, you know, many Bulgaria, many different countries. His books have been translated in total into 7 different languages, like English, Arabic. Maybe his works is the only, Risale-i Nur is the only Quranic commentary that is written outside Arabic language and translated into Arabic. And today it is published, printed in Saudi Arabia by a company, in Egypt by another company, in India also Arabic and English versions are printed, and in Istanbul. So worldwide, actually, his legacy today serving for the betterment of humanity. And just, you know, a short, maybe a few words, because I am already 5 minutes expired time. We have organized 7th International Graduate Conference on Nursi Studies. Students who are doing master and PhD studies from all over the world. Now, there are more than 200 students presently doing their master degree and PhD in Nursi study fields, especially in, you know, in Europe, in United States, in India, in many, you know, Middle Eastern countries, in Malaysia, Indonesia, and in those countries. And I think I would like to leave here. And thank you very much for your kind attention. Perhaps you can, you know, have a contribution and questions.